here's the game we really want to talk about. This is a game that deserves some close study, some spending some time on, and you will, if you study closely, be able to beat everyone you play unless they have invested enough time to learn what you have learned. It is simply the very same game, but we play it on three boards instead. Okay, so now the rules here are that a player on his move, his or her move, can put an X on any of the boards. You can choose whichever board you like. Now, as players put X's on the boards, eventually one of the boards is going to get three in a row. And then that board, but only that board, is declared dead at that point. You can't make any more moves then on that particular board. But you play on the remaining two. Again, on one of the two remaining boards, once three in a row is made, that board dies, is no longer available for play, and then you're left with whatever configuration of X's may be on the third board, and you complete that board. Then, whoever makes three in a row on the final board loses the game. Okay, this game is difficult to master, but it can be mastered. Starting from this position, you do want to move first. Now, in practice, if you learn how to play this game, you can even let your opponent move first because you usually know enough. You'll see a mistake they make and you'll be able to overcome that. But if you're playing someone who happens to be really good, then you do want to make sure that you move first. Then there's another strange twist to this game that on three boards, it actually doesn't even matter what move you make. All the first moves are winning. You can move wherever you want and it still is a winning position for you. So you can pretend to be very magnanimous and say, Brady, absolutely, please, just choose any cell. I will accept that as my winning, as my move. You don't say winning move. You say, I will accept that as my move and then we can play the game. So this is a nice trick you can play just when you're getting started. And then in general, you remember, on one board, it was the first player who wanted to go, and on three boards, it's also the first person. If you were to play the same game, I'm not recommending it, but if you were to play it on five, you would also want to move first. And on boards, if you have two, four, six boards, you don't want to move first, you want to move second. Now, I have to be completely honest with you, in order to play well and to be absolutely certain no one will ever beat you, you are going to have to know certain configurations of X patterns on the board and have them memorized. And it's not just the pattern you need to memorize, but you'll need to memorize a particular variable or symbol or fingerprint for each one. Then what you need to do is multiply those symbols together, which are just sort of like algebra things that you learn about in school, and then reach a certain safe configuration value. That's basically all there is to it. The rest of it is just memorization. This is small, so I need to put on my glasses. It is daunting, but it's not quite so daunting as it looks. This is a list of all the ways you can put up to 9 X's on a tic-tac-toe board. It turns out there are exactly 102 such ways. No one turn off the video, okay? There are 102 of these, but there are a lot of them that are very easy to remember. For example, if you look at the ones at the bottom here, you'll see there are ones here that are all given the number one or the identity. We're going to be multiplying these things together, so the ones that already have completed rows of X's, they're already dead boards. And so those are like the identity. When we're multiplying things together, if a board is already dead, it doesn't matter. So it's just the number one. You don't need to memorize dead boards because you look at it and it already has an X through it. You don't even have to remember those. So the only ones you need to focus on are the ones where there's still play available. And for each of those, it's going to be a symbol. And a symbol is just going to be like a single algebraic term. Like it might be an A, it might be a B squared, it might be a BC, it might be a D squared, or so on. And that's what all you have to remember, plus a couple things having to do with reducing words and simplifying them. Let me just show you some typical fingerprints. Okay, one of them is, say, just an X in the corner. That happens to be the identity, or the number one. It's a fingerprint which does nothing. It's the same as a dead board. If there's only one thing in the corner, you can ignore it. Another dead board is the one where the X is here. This is also a one. All right? We want to be systematic here. So what is the last one, Brady? What would the last one be?
An X in the middle.
It would be an X in the middle, exactly. So if we have this one, that one is slightly different. This I am going to call C squared. There are certain positions that come up a lot more than others. When you look at the big table, you say, oh, I can't do this, this is too hard. Well, no, it's not too hard. You just have to play more and just kind of get used to it. Okay, so let's take some typical ones that come up all the time. Okay, so one of them is this one. This comes up a lot. And this happens to be B squared. Okay, that's a good one. One of them is when you have two X's on the corners, or opposite corners, like this, an A. That comes up a lot. The one that has ones like this, and that one also happens to be an A. Okay, let's say you go to the trouble of learning all of these fingerprints. How is that going to help you? Well, let's see. Let's start a hypothetical game. Let's say that I've made this first move X. I look at this position and I like it. Why do I like it? Because this happens to be a 1. This one happens to be a C. And this one happens to be a C. And when I multiply these two together, in my head, I get C squared. And C squared happens to be one of the magical polynomials, or just monomials, that I want to leave in every position to make sure I win. C squared. So you have to remember, I like C squared. So what are the other ones? There's C squared, there's also the letter A, there's B squared, and there's B times C, and that's it. Those are the four you need to remember. Those four ones, if you make a move so that the fingerprints multiply to one of those possibilities, then there's no way for your opponent to regain control. You will still win the game. So at each stage, you are always trying to find a move that equals an A, a BC, a B squared, or a C squared. Well, let's say our opponent decides, they're free, of course, to move on any of these three boards, but let's say that my opponent decides to move on the same one here and moves here. Okay, what's a good reply here? Well, there's actually a quite nice reply. Remember, C squared was itself a good move, and if I kill this board by moving here, then it's completely out of play and I'm only going to be left with these two. So that's going to be a C squared too. Boom, I do this. I'm still under control, and I've killed one board also, so we're getting closer to winning also. When you're playing this game, you tend to look first at the options that involve killing boards, right? It's better, you know, think of it like a samurai. It's better to kill your opponent sooner rather than later, because if you let them linger, you know, they may rise up and, you know, all of a sudden surprise you. Okay, so I always look first, is there a good move that involves killing something that's already on the board? So now let's say my opponent plays to, let's play here. Okay, so that one, if you remember, that's a 1 now. So I cross out this C and I make this a 1. Now we multiply these two together. It's no longer C squared. It is now multiplying to C.
That's bad.
That is bad. That is not one of the, I mean, it's good for me because I need, if it were a C squared, that would be bad because I'd have no winning move, right? Remember, that's what I'm trying to do to someone else. But if it's a C, I know there is a winning move. I just need to figure out what is the winning move. Another one that I've happened to memorize, and it's a very simple one, is just that if you have two like this, one in the center and then one on the edge connected, it can be on the diagonal or oriented however you like, that's always a B. Okay, so this is a B. That's a B. And, you know, and all, of course, all the reflections and rotations and so on. These are all Bs.
All right.
Okay? Yep. All right, so that's what I'm going to do here. I'm going to change this away from a 1. It's no longer a 1. It's now a B. And now I have B times C, and that's one of the magic ones. So now I'm no longer at C. Now I'm at BC, and I'm still happy. I'm still winning. I left my opponent facing a losing position, a BC. Now let's say, what do they do? Well, one thing they could do is, you know, I killed a board, maybe they're dumb enough to, you know, kill a board too. So let's say that they kill this one. Boom. Okay, so now this is now what? It's the identity, it's dead. So it's just the number 1, right? Remember, you know, from algebra, you multiply by 1, has no effect. So all the dead boards, they're always 1. Now you've got a C. Well, we've already talked about this, haven't we? What is the winning move when we have one board? Right? What is the winning move? The winning move is not to move on the edge, remember, it's to move in the middle. So we do this. Okay, now we still have to win this, but we know how to do that too. We just do the knight's move strategy. Okay, so my opponent might move here. I move a knight's move away here. Now my opponent, maybe they move here. I move a knight's move away there. And now my opponent is dead, and I have won, demonstrating my mastery that I hope all the number file video people will also become my rivals, although I don't look forward to it, of tic-tac-toe on three boards in Mazur play. So good luck to everybody.
This video and all number file videos you watch are supported by the Mathematical Sciences Research Institute here in Berkeley, California. That's the building behind me. If you'd like to find out more about the mathematics and the mathematics outreach that's done here, check out the links in the video description.